this whole topic, I would say, has been on the back burner because there's been so much excitement and interest in the new drugs, the androgen receptor axis targeted therapies. But there's actually a lot happening in this area, and I would say it isn't well known. It should be. And there are simple interventions that we can all use to improve quality of life and survival. And they should be used more than they are. And one of the key messages is that there's a lot of unwanted effects that you can ameliorate. And as someone putting a patient on ADT, I think it's your responsibility to look after these, because in many constituencies, it varies. The family doctors just either they aren't interested, you're putting the patient on the drug, you look after the side effects, or they may just not be knowledgeable. So these unwanted effects are well known, the metabolic syndrome, insulin resistance, hyperglycemia, cardiovascular disease, sarcopenia, they're related, frailty, loss of muscle mass, cognitive changes, of course, sexual dysfunction, hot flashes, and a loss of bone mineral density, and fragility, fractures. And so as I start with the take-home message, these unwanted effects can in many cases be minimized by appropriate interventions. The primary care physicians are often aware of these, and it's our responsibility. So the metabolic syndrome, I think most people are aware of this now. The classic one, five criteria, hypertriglyceridemia, hyperglycemia, hypertension, obesity, and increased HDL. And three of these five constitutes the metabolic syndrome. And it's estimated that in men on ADT, first of all, metabolic syndrome and prostate cancer co-segregate. So the predisposing factors are similar for both, including things like diet, obesity, and so on. But it's estimated that in men going on ADT, that risk increases from 30 to 50, more than 50%. So it's a common phenomenon. So I'm going to just briefly address mainly these four topics: statins, oral bone targeted agents, metformin, exercise, and a little bit about intermittent therapy. So the first point is the statins. This is the chart that every resident learns going through until he does his exams and then promptly forgets it. The three pathways for androgen synthesis: the cholesterol pathway that goes through testosterone, a lipophilic molecule that diffuses passively into all cells, the backdoor pathway, so-called because it goes directly to DHT without going through testosterone. This is the pathway that's powerfully upregulated in CRPC in prostate cancer cells, so-called intracrine synthesis. This is the pathway that's inhibited by abiraterone. The one I want to focus on is the adrenal pathway. The adrenal doesn't make testosterone, but it makes DHEA, the well-known supplement, and then androstenediol. And androstenediol is a source for intracellular testosterone in the castrate environment. But unlike testosterone, it's a polar molecule with these two hydroxy groups, so it requires a transporter to get into the cell. The transporter is called HSD3B. The name doesn't really matter. The point is, this is a transporter that is also used by drugs, and in particular by the statins, and it's a competitive binding. So by giving a statin, you inhibit the cellular uptake of androstenediol and therefore reduce the substrate available for testosterone synthesis in the castrate environment. And this has been demonstrated in preclinical models, and there's now three studies that all show the same thing, which is, not aside from the cardiovascular benefit and aside from the benefit in lipid profile, that statins improve the prostate cancer outcome. It's a prostate cancer drug. Here is one fairly recent study, a population study, 87,000 men, two-thirds were on statins, and the rest were not. A benefit in terms of overall survival, caused specific survival, hazard ratio 0.56. You know, this is real. We just published this. This is a secondary analysis of the PR7 intermittent versus continuous trial from a decade ago. So we look back at what was the impact of statins and a benefit in terms of overall survival and a modest benefit, but look at the hazard ratios, 0.65, 0.84. It all reached statistical significance, showing a benefit from statins. Why don't we put all these patients on statins? It has both cardiovascular and prostate cancer benefits. The next one is the bone mineral density. So I think this is well known. You get loss of bone mineral density somewhere around 2% in the first year, and then it continues. It's the risk of fracture is estimated around 40%. So it's at 10 years of ADT, it's actually the majority of at least have osteoporosis. And this is clinically relevant in terms of fragility fracture risk. And there are multiple trials. So I did one. I'm very partial to it, a randomized trial of men going on Lupron, previously untreated, plus or minus one pill a week of alendronate. So the thing is, this is cheap. It's pretty non-toxic. It's once a week. And after 1 year, you got the predictable 2% loss in the placebo group and a 2% gain in the treatment group. Why don't we do this? The alternative is like Q6 monthly denosumab, but I prefer the once a week pill because it's quite inexpensive. There's no injection involved. And there's now these multiple trials. They all show the same thing, improvement in bone mineral density, loss of a reduction in fragility fractures. And there's many ways you can do this. But somehow we got caught up in the denosumab zoledronic acid track and forgot about just the simple bisphosphonates. They're widely used for postmenopausal women, but hardly at all in prostate cancer. And then the third one is metformin. And Mark Moyad mentioned something about this yesterday. So there's two randomized trials. These are not well known. They're small, but they're both strongly positive. You give metformin in addition to ADT, lower fasting glucose, not surprising. No hypoglycemia, by the way, in the non-diabetic men, and that's also true for people not on ADT. But lower fasting glucose and waist circumference, and one, improvements in abdominal girth, weight, BMI, blood pressure in the other study. Again, this is innocuous, inexpensive. I think it makes a lot of sense. And then exercise. We're at a Dave Crawford meeting. Everyone here knows about how important exercise is. If it were a pill, we would all take it. But eight different ways that exercise has been demonstrated to improve the tumor microenvironment in prostate cancer: cytokine alteration, epigenetic modulation, alteration hormone levels, and so on. And then the final point is this whole issue, the agonist versus antagonist. So I think probably everyone here has heard about this now, the evidence beginning with the Degarelix studies and the pool analysis that I did with Peter Albertson, demonstrating a 50% reduction in cardiovascular events in men with pre-existing cardiovascular disease who were on Degarelix compared to an LHRH agonist. And this has been now repeated in numerous prospective trials. This meta-analysis was just published a couple of months ago by collaborators and myself. And again, it shows pretty convincingly a benefit in terms of cardiovascular events, overall mortality, and cardiovascular death in the, this was generally Degarelix compared to LHRH. And, you know, why should this be? And frankly, this came as a surprise to me because the conventional wisdom is, you know, metabolic syndrome due to low testosterone results in risk of cardiovascular disease. But there's these two other explanations: the difference in FSH in men on antagonist compared to agonist, and probably more, as or more important, stimulation of LHRH receptors in the immunocytes, T helper cells and macrophages, in endothelial plaques in men going on these drugs, because they are, after all, agonists. The LHRH receptors have been demonstrated to be present on these immunologic cells. And so briefly, the FSH is reduced 90% in men on Degarelix compared to about 40% reduction in men on agonists. I'm just going to show one preclinical study because it's such an amazing study. How often do we get Nature papers that are in our area? And this was transgenic mice engineered to develop cardiovascular disease, hyperlipidemia, obesity. All they did was put one group on an anti-FSH antibody and the other group on a control antibody. So the FSH antibody is the red bar, and just simply inhibiting FSH with an antibody resulted in decreased obesity. This is fat. This is fat mass to total mass. And you can see the photomicrographs. You compare the one on the left to the one on the right. This really made a difference. Think of postmenopausal women and their high FSH and predisposition to obesity. There's a lot of clinical support for this. And one other kind of natural experiment is patients who have orchidectomy for prostate cancer, of course, have very high levels of FSH. And most of the studies show that these patients, compared to an agonist, have an increase in weight, fat mass, subcutaneous mass, and so on. This is a Scandinavian study from a couple years ago. So let me just, this is the macrophage and T helper cell story, that the agonist results in expansion of the immunologic compartment in these endothelial plaques, resulting in chronic inflammation, plaque instability, plaque rupture. With the antagonist, you don't get that. This is some animal data. I'm out of time, pretty much. One randomized study from Israel actually confirming that observation. And then, of course, the HERO study, Arello Gullux in the New England Journal recently. And though, if you look at the patients with a history of MACE, they have endothelial plaques, they have cardiovascular disease, very substantial difference in the rate of MACE events in relugolix compared to leuprolide, really supporting this hypothesis. The one caveat here is, you see, there were not grade 3 and 4 MACE events. So these were either grade 1 or 2 events or fatalities. It looks like, it's not clear from the paper, but it looks like they were in fact fatalities and therefore quite a meaningful difference. I think I'll bang through that. So just to summarize, I call this the ABCDEF of ADT. As the clinician putting patients on, you need to have awareness of the metabolic effects, address the bone health issue, alendronate or denosumab, treat with statins. I think every patient on ADT should be on statins. Smoking cessation, obvious. Intermittent hormone therapy, I don't have time to talk about another way to reduce the impact. Diet, diabetes with metformin. Exercise, and if they have pre-existing cardiovascular disease and they don't mind a 1-monthly injection, or perhaps going forward, the oral agent, Firmagon. Thank you very much.